Welcome, everybody. Monika Szewczyk, learning from Athens, working title in brackets. Why in brackets?
Actually, we're still trying to figure out if we're going to use it or if Documenta needs a title. But it's been very productive for making it.
Does it has already a title? A new title?
Come on. Not a new title. No. But it's really been. I'm being very open about our internal deliberations. But it's really just been. A discussion inside, do we keep a title or does Documenta...
But you still need to be a little bit discreet of what all is happening.
Huh? Yes.
We are doing it now for the third time in between a year. It was everywhere a little bit different, but we had a talk exactly a year ago in Toronto, followed by another talk in Vancouver February in Toronto, and then December in Vancouver. We are kind of trained, but we do it a little bit different today. Monika will give a presentation, but I will give you some background about Monika, about Documenta, and why we are doing this new series called Art History Today, Kunstgeschichte Heute, which is a new series. We thought, what can we talk about exhibitions? Can we, in art history today, can we talk about exhibition making or only about individual artists, individual artworks? And it turned out that we focus, especially in the beginning, a lot of this year's big events coming up, Documenta, Skulpturprojekte Münster with Britta Peters soon, her presentation, when is it? February 28th, and then Vanessa Joan Müller, my colleague, dear colleague Vanessa Joan Müller, who will be responsible to create the Albanian Pavilion Venice this year. As this three big events, Documenta, Münster, Venice, happen almost at the same time. This only happens every 10 years. 10 years ago, marketing people called it Grand Tour. Is it?
I don't think it's.
No, it was also a stupid idea, to do it like this. It was just a marketing idea, I think. I have so many notes. Monika Szewczyk organizes exhibitions, writes, edits, and teaches, most often in partnership with institutions of art and higher learning. Not anymore so much. No? So you're all told.
Depending if you want to see Documenta as an institution of higher learning.
I think we will talk about it later. Before joining the curatorial team of Documenta 14 in January 2015, is that right? She was the visual arts program curator at the Reverend David Logan Center, a very American title, Logan Center for Arts at the University of Chicago. Previously, she was the head of publications and curator at Witte de Witte Center for Contemporary Art in Rotterdam, the Netherlands, where we have worked together for 6 years. And before that, you have been assistant curator at the Vancouver Art Gallery in Vancouver, Canada, where we also met about, 15, 12 years ago. Monika, some geopolitical notes, is not a refugee, but born in Poland and moved as a child to, like so many people, as a child to Canada in the 1980s. Documenta, the first Documenta created by Kassel painter and academy professor Arnold Bode in 1955, was an unexpected world success. It was not planned in the beginning that a Documenta became a series of, or a biennial, or this kind of event. The exhibition, which was launched at the, some of you may know, accompanying program to the Bundesgartenschau, German Federal Horticultural Show, that was held in Kassel that year, took an historical and documentary reconstructive approach. In terms of the first exhibition concept, the first Documenta expressly manifested its goal of directly referring the Nazis' propaganda exhibition Degenerate Art, held in 1937 in order to restore the prominence of the works, styles, and artists so downgraded in the German public estimation as a result of the 1937 show. Alongside Venice Biennale Documenta is seen still as the most important regularly occurring exhibition of contemporary, in the beginning modern art in the world. It has reflected the common notion of a centralized art world, as for many, many years only European and US American artists were represented. In 2017, Documenta 14, also in a couple of months, will establish a second site for the very first time, a second site in Athens, placing Kassel and the Greek capital on equal footing. Is that true? Is it really equal footing? As the two locations of the exhibition. It's not for the very first time, as it's the first time that there is an equal second site, but already in 2002, Oakwee and Weser started in relocating certain events far away from Kassel, and in the last Documenta was held partly directed by Caroline Christoph Bakagiev in Kabul, Banff in Canada, and in Cairo. Please welcome Monika with me, and we go into a conversation after your presentation. Thank you for being here.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Nikolaus. It's always a great pleasure to come wherever you have established your domain. We had an amazing time with Nikolaus at Vita de Vit. He's a master of choosing teams, I think, of people. And he really taught me a lot about how important it is to have this great group of colleagues. He was really bringing together incredible people, both within the team of Vita de Vit, but also always bringing together past colleagues like he's doing to me now. So I met Vanessa Joan Muller also, and worked with her as a writer and as a contributor to our talks program and various things. So it's really nice to be here. It's also a little bit strange for me always to be in Vienna, because actually when I left Poland in 1985, I passed through Dreiskirchen for a month, which is a refugee camp very close to Vienna. So it's strange how life kind of takes you through cities and then takes you through cities again. So I always think of this moment that we're living in now, with, you know, a migration crisis announced on the news. Of course, migration is a reality for many people for years and years, and just recently it's reached levels where, of course, numbers are kind of surpassing the numbers that we saw after the Second World War. So it is indeed a moment of crisis, but it's also a kind of return to something that's happened. Actually, I'm just noticing that right now on the Documenta 14 website, there is we've posted Hannah Arendt's We Refugees, which is an essay that was published in the first South as a State of Mind Documenta issue. I'll get back to that maybe, to the South, a little bit later. I thought it's really hard to give a talk about Documenta when you're 2 months away from actually opening the exhibition. I feel completely inside of the last moments of production, and at the same time, I'm not really supposed to talk in an official capacity about everything that we will present, because the idea is to entice you all to come and actually see the show and not feel like, you know, everything has been given to you ahead of time and you're kind of going to Athens and then to Kassel to tick off boxes. As a result, we haven't published a list of artists that will participate, or given this kind of foreshadowing of what is happening. But we've been in Athens. I moved to Athens in 2015, or actually at the very end of 2014. So even though the 100 days of Documenta begins on April 8th, excuse me, we've been working for 2 years steady now, trying to forge alliances. It's really quite a different situation working in Athens than it is making Documenta in Kassel. Kassel calls itself Documenta Stadt. You go there, you say you're working for Documenta, and everybody wants to give you a hug. And they, you know, doors open and everybody's friendly. Everybody has 100 stories about past Documentas. You feel, you know, incredible. In Athens, the documenta just means documents. That is the plural word for document in the Greek. So there isn't very much, or there hasn't been in the first part of our time there, a lot of name recognition or a lot of recognition of what we're actually doing. So it's been a very different situation. Athens is also a much bigger city, with a much kind of older tradition of art on display, let's say. So your perspective shifts completely. And of course, it's further south. And this idea of moving, making the move to Athens for Documenta is a kind of sense of moving south. It's not so much a kind of entrenched look from a particular viewpoint, Athens, but it's a movement. That's kind of been in the back of our minds as we work, or at least in the back of my mind as we work, or as I work. And I thought, I gave the title, The Work of Art History, The Work of Making Art History, excuse me, to this talk because I was really actually quite happy to hear from Vanessa and from Nikolaos that they were making a series on art history. I think art history is a kind of beleaguered profession. I'm not trained as a curator. I never went to curatorial college or curatorial training programs. I studied art history. And I quite loved art history as a discipline, actually. But it felt in a very strange way that it was in a kind of dead end when I was at university. And therefore, it also felt like I needed to get into another field in order to really get in touch with the kind of art that I had learned about, but being made in the present. So I basically got busy working at first a university art gallery, then the Vancouver Art Gallery, where Nikolaos and I met. And I think it's, in terms of the question of art history and how we make it, I think it has a lot to do with, as curators, for me at least, or as writers, getting close to as close to as possible to the making process of artists themselves. And that's a great privilege, actually, of being a curator. Of course, if you're an artist, you're already very, very close to your own process. But it's a very interesting perspective to not necessarily be making the work yourself, but to somehow sweep the floor for the work to be made, as it were. And I thought to just give a very brief kind of show and tell of three projects that I think are really telling of the kind of work that I personally have really tried to champion for this documenta. There's going to be quite a large variety of positions that you will see. I'm one of 10 curators, so this is by no means a kind of overview. And there's actually no attempt to provide a kind of Olympic viewpoint in the documenta as such. It's going to be quite a broken mirror, as it were. And I think even the fact that you have two cities already produces this kind of impossibility of seeing everything the documenta will overlap for 5 weeks, so you will not be able to be in two places at the same time. And it's structurally, that kind of difficulty is a perspectival kind of, or an existential kind of dilemma that Adam Szymczyk really felt strongly about instilling into the experience of showing and viewing, getting close to art, and that, you know, as a curator invited to participate, I was quite excited to kind of see. So what you're seeing here is three of 12 shades of indigo that a master indigo dyer can produce once they have gone through the proper training. This is the backyard of the Mentis Center for the Preservation of Traditional Greek Textiles in Athens. It's a small factory formerly run by a family, the Mentis family, which has beautiful machines that weave threads together into ropes and various notions, let's say, that kind of went defunct, as many such places have gone defunct since about the 80s in Greece. But in a kind of visionary way, a woman called Virginia Matseli, who's the director of Mentis now, approached the Benaki Museum in Athens to preserve this factory as a museum, but instead of making everything beautiful and having you be able to see what a machine looks like, her idea is that for the Center for the Preservation of Traditional Greek Textiles to be a museum, the machines have to work. So they've been a really interesting partner for us, and somehow this philosophy of a museum that actually preserves factory work is something that keeps my mind alive and really interested. This is Aboubakar Fofana. He's an artist from Mali, from Bamako, but he's based in France, mostly in Paris and in Bamako. Outside of Bamako, he has a kind of sustainable farm that he is trying to develop in order to grow indigo. His indigo supply about 3 years ago kind of disappeared because he was sourcing indigo in Guinea, and a virus hit the plantation, and basically his crop disappeared overnight. So he decided to take the land that he had bought a few years prior and really commit himself to farming as well as making indigo. He left Mali when he was 10 and lived in France, but at about in his 20s he returned and started to talk to people and try to basically hang out with people that were still making indigo in the traditional way, meaning picking indigo leaves, drying them, making indigo balls out of these dried leaves, and then creating vats where indigo ferments in the way that almost alcohol ferments. And out of this fermentation process, a cloth can be dyed in various shades of blue. He's actually wearing also different shades of indigo, I'm just noticing in this picture. It was a very sunny day, and Greece is a very sunny place, but this is December 20th, and it was freezing. So we also had a few challenges setting up the indigo vat. I just wanted to show you also a little bit of the inside of Mentis, the Center for the Preservation of Textiles. That's Mr. Spiros. He's somebody who runs all the machines. I'm pointing at my own screen. I should be pointing at this screen. That's Mr. Spiros with Aboubakar, basically preparing Greek cotton thread to be dyed in indigo. And I'll just show you a little bit of what this process looks like, because it's quite a magical... how do I do this? Whoops. pardon me. Voila, that's nicer. So the thread is washed and it has to be rinsed. This has been rinsed about 3 times, and then basically you have a sense of a little bit of the dyeing process. And when the threads come out of the vat, they're kind of yellowy green. And then through the process of oxidization, you get a beautiful blue, this kind of deep, dark blue indigo. This kind of artistic practice, which basically, it takes, I mean, he has been at this for, I think about 25 years from the beginning of trying to learn how indigo is cultivated, and the entire history of how it has become this kind of magical substance. It has antiseptic properties. You see Tuareg men, especially in the Sahel Desert, wearing indigo all over as a protective kind of covering. It's both medicinally protective and also spiritually protected, protective. What I've learned from Abu Bakar is that, you know, the fact that these leaves are making the vat and then the vat is used for dyeing this means that the color actually maintains a life. And a part of the spiritual importance of indigo clothing, indigo textiles, is this sense that there is a kind of animated spirit in the cloth. And there is a life and kind of deep spirituality to it. It was really interesting when I visited Bamako and went to the museum in Mali. One of the most important displays in that museum is a display of cloth. And the opening panel of that museum display simply says that here in something to the effect of, I'm paraphrasing, but here in Mali, we believe that clothing yourself every day is a sign of respect for your fellow humans, and therefore a great amount of importance is put on the production of cloth. And you had textile displays in that museum, which really made me think how, in a way, we don't really have this kind of place in the West for textiles. We mostly put textiles in applied arts museums or on our bodies, of course. But there isn't a kind of elevation of this type of work alongside contemporary fine art. Very often, contemporary artists these days are working with people who know as much about these traditional techniques, but they will hire them to produce contemporary art, so they will recontextualize this kind of work. So that somehow the challenge of working with somebody like Abu Bakar has been to think about how to push the envelope a bit further. He's quite aware of the contemporary art world, but also completely aware of, you know, traditions that talk to each other between Mali and Japan and India and southern China. And it's a very different kind of geography of practice that is being sketched out. And it's a lot of manual hard work. So not exactly the kind of work that actually is mostly emphasized in academies these days. You know, I've had some experience teaching in art academies, and I feel like there has been a kind of evacuation of the depth of what this kind of work actually does to art history. So what he's actually doing here is dyeing thread that will be used for a very special purpose. I'm maybe going to advance to another image, although this is quite beautiful, I think, and kind of meditative. But I do want to show you a little bit more of something else, so I'll just collapse this and just keep going with these images for a second. You see this thread in different colors, so as the vat got older, the blue that you achieve from the vat gets lighter, and you have to dip these threads in longer in order to achieve a color, and then in some cases you choose to leave them light, so you have a kind of gradation and a sense of the different possibilities. So I just wanted to show you one more film, which is a little bit more maybe enigmatic. This is my attempt from outside. You were just in the courtyard of the Mentis factory, and now I have turned around and I'm looking inside the Mentis factory at some of the machinery that's operating inside. And it's super beautiful machinery that has actually been at work since the beginning of the last century and is completely functional and produces many different ribbons, threads, all kinds of textile notions. And what we decided to do in Documenta is we're producing a reader which will collect a lot of essays, theoretical essays, which I won't tell you about because you have to come, of course, and get the book and read all of it. But what I can tell you is that the bookmark that will mark the pages of this reader is actually produced in this very slow, painstaking way at the Mentis factory. And it's from thread hand-dyed by Aboubakar Fofana and then spun into exactly what you see here, which is just a very, very, very simple ribbon. And it's taken days, and I would say actually decades, because in order to do it as efficiently as we did, or as he did, he needed quite many years of training. And at the end, what you get is these very simple ribbons spinning into a kind of, or a very simple, sorry, threads spinning into a ribbon that my camera is struggling to focus on, but I know there is a part of this film that will show you. I also, somehow when I was training the camera on this process, thought this is kind of a beautiful image of how we're trying to pull together Documenta, is all these different threads, people running around doing their work, and somehow if we're doing it well and if everybody is dancing, then we will manage to produce something that is clear and as pleasurable as seeing this thing being produced. I say dancing because actually the Greek machines that produce these textiles are the formations of these machines actually determine the formation of traditional Greek dances. So you have this kind of incredible continuity between textiles and dancing and therefore music. There's an incredible rhythm here. I don't have sound on this, but I think the rhythm is as visual as it is oral in this case. And I have to say, working with this project, with this artist, was a really eye-opening kind of process for me, and in some ways it gelled. It gelled somehow the work of another artist that I had been working with, and here I can show you just maybe this in the snow, our bookmark is being made. So this is a very different image of work. And this is the work of the other artist. This photograph is called Amalia Poole Working. Amalia Poole is a Ford model living in Chicago who was hired to model the shoes that you see on her feet, which are called Borosana shoes. They're ergonomic shoes produced in Vukovar, not far from here, in Croatia. Although they were developed in Vukovar when that part of the world was Yugoslavia. And for about 9 years, women working in the factory worked out the perfect shoe for 9 hours of standing labor. It took a while because they were trying to place a ball underneath the foot that would kind of support the arch in a way that would also align the spine. And I can testify for you that these are indeed the most comfortable shoes you can wear. I wore them when we had the conference here, which, yeah, about curatorial concerns. And I continue to wear them. This is an image shot at the Logan Center, the David and Riva Logan Center for the Arts, that long name at the University of Chicago. It's a kind of strange building built, I think, to convince parents that it's okay for their children to go into the arts because it will look like a business boardroom when they go to classes. So this is one of these rooms, and the artist who is responsible for this image, who's actually sitting with us today, Irena Hajduk, used this strange boardroom and a mirror and invited this model to produce this image. And I really like that it's called Amalia Poole Working. I would love for Vogue one day to just name their images, you know, Kate Moss working, or Naomi Campbell working, or Linda Evangelista working for $10,000 and nothing less. I don't know, but this is a kind of insistence, I think, on the image of labor in our world, but without this kind of cliche of the image of labor that 19th century realism sometimes delivered to us, although I don't want to kind of flatten the complexity of 19th century realism and those images of labor. I love many of them, but this is something fresh. And what's interesting about it is that the image is also working to convince you to wear the shoes. It is an actual advertisement. It's not pretending to be something higher. It's actually enticing you to wear the shoes. So the project that it is a part of, which is called 9 Hour Delay, is involves the introduction of this shoe into the female workforce of a given art institution. So we tried this on a really small scale at the Logan Center. This was an image that was also used to advertise. These black tears were a kind of enigmatic feature of the advertisement, which maybe gave it a slightly darker tone. To me, it looks like a kind of Eastern European nail bar somewhere in, I don't know where, but it has a kind of familiarity to me that I cannot fully describe, but I'm just sharing it. And, you know, people basically took the shoes out of the media center, and we decided to dispense them from the media center of this place because the shoes are kind of like clocks. They measure the amount of time that you work. It's called 9 hour delay because they are intended for 9 hours of standing labor, but of course these days we don't only stand as we work, and very often when you're working in the kinds of professions that I'm kind of assuming everybody here is familiar with, I might be overstretching it a little bit, but there's a lot of people who don't really have a clear barrier between their work time and their other time, be it leisure or free time or something else. And this is a kind of colonization of time that is actually quite dangerous. This shoe, I think, tries to make you aware of that. So we tried to do this inside of an exhibition that I curated called The Fifth Dimension. And, you know, maybe 30 women participated because there were students and there were professors, but it wasn't like a mass mobilization. It's quite as, you know, the gallery that I was running was about as big as this room. And we did kind of experimental things on a micro scale, but they really stuck with me. And it was great preparatory ground for Documenta. So now, for Documenta 14, we are going to try this on a much bigger scale. And the Borovo factory is actually in production at the moment. And 9-hour delay is going to be a part of Irena Hajduk's contribution, but it is only a part of her contribution. It is somehow incorporated, this part, into the broader presence of Yugo Export, which is a corporation that she calls an oral corporation, and which she incorporated in the US, where corporations are people. So we can refer to Yugo Export as she. I have actually with me the incorporation documents of Yugo Export, and they are subtitled How to Surround Yourself with Things in the Right Way. And I think this is a beautiful question or a beautiful prompt for life, also for installing exhibitions and for many things. And Yugo Export is a kind of copy or avatar of an existing company, again, one that was founded in the former Yugoslavia in the 50s. And it was founded, and in the early 2000s, it started to fall into bankruptcy. And just in December, the flagship store of Yugo Export, after kind of laying dormant in the center of Belgrade, was finally sold to a kind of meat distributor who's become a millionaire. And it's difficult to say what is going to happen, but the real life result of this is that the workforce of Yugo Export, women who are incredibly skilled in cutting patterns, in sewing, in modeling, are out of a job. So what the new Yugo Export under Irena Hajduk's guidance has done actually is to hire these women to work for the avatar, to work for the copy, to work for the new Yugo Export. And what is being produced is the Yugo form. I'm going to do something I never do in these things, but I'm going to stand up because I'm actually wearing the Yugo form right now. This is a dress that is modeled after a fascist pattern that was produced in Italy in about 1908 to liberate women from the corset. So it's cut on a bias, meaning that I can fit it, but also someone wider than me can fit it because it stretches. And it's very comfortable. I can wear it every day. It has, you know, this kind of universal applicability day for night, anything you want. I'm also wearing Yugo Export pins. If you come to Documenta, you too might be able to get one. This is part of the Yugo form, which will be worn by women who are part of what Irena Hajduk calls an army of beautiful women. Now, we can definitely talk about what it means to celebrate militancy amongst women and the downfall of that. I don't necessarily want to get into too much of a defense and an explanation, because I think a demonstration is probably much more effective. So I will just tell you that the Army of Beautiful Women is coming, and they will be wearing Yugo forms. They will be comfortable, and they will basically permeate documenta. That is a large part of the presence of Yugo export in documenta 14, but that presence is complex. It's a process of incorporation, so it's incorporating other works. 9-hour delay, the project with the shoes is one of them. The other one is SER, or seductive exacting realism. It's a project that involves two rooms, a waiting room and a listening room. The waiting room is somehow dramatizing the process of waiting in countries that have fallen into debt and into economic downfall, and they continue to wait for a kind of economic recovery. In the listening room, you hear more of the process of how this happens and how it actually aligns with the processes of art making. What you hear concretely is a conversation. It's a conversation that's based on an actual conversation that Irena Hajduk had with Sergio Popovic, who is the founder of Otpor, which means resist and or resistance, and also the founder of Canvas, which is a consultancy that consults governments and businesses throughout the world on kind of non-violent revolution. Canvas has had its hands in Egypt, in Ukraine, in various parts of the world that we witness kind of staging resistance. And this conversation is re-recorded and spoken by the voices of the woman who is Siri in China, and another woman who sounds exactly like Rachel from Blade Runner. This kind of masks the Eastern European accents of Irena Hajduk and Sergio Popovic, making things a little bit more confusing. And it just produces a slightly different tone. Tone being quite important. In some ways, when you listen to this conversation, you get a kind of prehistory of Yugo export as a corporation. So you start to realize what an oral corporation is. An oral corporation is, of course, a corporation that is looking into the value of oral tradition and the value of a kind of blind work. And I'm not going to explain this because Irena Hajduk is sitting right here. So if you're curious about what this blindness is about, maybe we can just ask her, because I think it's nice to just open it up soon to questions. The last thing I thought to kind of leave you with is, if you're curious about... If you're curious about sort of the mentality of some of these artists in documenta, I wanted to point to one more. I thought three is a good number that I'm working with personally. And that's a man called Joaquin Orellana, who's actually a composer living in Guatemala City. And we have published an interview with him which is called The Sound of Hunger, to create the sound of hunger. The interview is with Stefan Benchoham and Julio Santos and Alejandro Torun. Julio Santos is a choral conductor, and Stefan Benchoham is an artist and runs Proyectos Ultravioleta in Guatemala City. Alejandro Torun is a kind of business person who's also very much involved in music in the country. What Oriana did that really struck me as interesting was that he started to produce what he calls sound utensils. He went to the Instituto di Tela in Argentina, in Buenos Aires, which is a very famous experimental zone for art and for music. And you know, when he went there, it was this kind of moment of atonal music and avant-gardism, and a lot of computer-generated electronic music very early on. This is like this late 60s. He comes back to Guatemala, none of the equipment is actually available to him, and he has to start from scratch in some sense. So he took the marimba, which is the national instrument of Guatemala, and started to somehow play around with the form and produced these kind of sculptural variations on the marimba. Here you see one, which he very nicely called sound utensils. It's like having a sound. You know, I think of playing spoons or something. It has this kind of very beautiful humility and at the same time a kind of obstinate, I think, insistence on utility in art. He shows these as sculptures, but he doesn't show them as sculptures unless you commit to playing them. And he's currently at work on a symphony, which is called the Symphony from the Third World, where these instruments will be used. And the symphony will premiere in Athens in June 29th. So I thought I would invite you to the symphony and let's create some music by talking together.
Yeah. Thank you, Monika. If the documenta, both Athens and Kassel, is speaking in such a beautiful rhetoric way about production, then it will be a different kind of documenta, with that's my perception, with a less intellectual approach than the previous documentas from since 1997. But let's wait. That's the talking about Athens. This documenta still has a political mission towards its citizenry in Athens and in Greece. How is it in Kassel? You said that earlier, it's a mega event, and all people on the street, all people, you know, people grew up with it. That's different in Athens. How do people, local people, respond to it if they, or have they heard about documenta? People from the street.
In Kassel?
In
Athens.
Yes.
I think it's becoming more recognized. There's been quite a bit of press. In our past conversations, I've pulled up this image where I'm pretty sure, the students of the Art Academy in Athens, which is our oldest partner in Athens. It became a partner quite early on. And the ASFA, the Athens School of Fine Arts, was a kind of important partner because of this working title and this working ethos, I would say, learning from Athens. It felt very nice to align ourselves with an academy. So in some ways, that was great, but it's an academy with, you know, students with minds of their own. And at a certain point outside the documenta offices, we saw this stencil that said, "Dear documenta, I refuse to exoticize myself to raise your cultural capital," signed I Ithagenis, which means the indigenous ones. This was quite a statement, I think. A kind of opposition to documenta in Athens, and a sense that the kind of maybe working title, learning from Athens, had been interpreted as this laboratory experiment on Athens. I think that's where, in some ways, the notion of feeling exoticized was coming from. But I think there is a deeper sense of feeling kind of colonized in this new way, which is extremely soft and polite and doesn't come with arms and, you know, a lot of force, but kind of happens financially or happens very politely. And they resisted this. And I thought, chapeau, this is cool. People are alert here. And it kind of started an interesting, I think, tension, you know, conversation. And we've subsequently, there is now a group of anthropologists in Athens who have started a group called Learning from Documenta. So they have kind of turned the tables on us.
Yeah, but they wouldn't call it Learning from Kassel.
No. They would not. They're more focused on what is Documenta doing to them in Athens, let's say, and how I think, you know, it's not like a bare embrace, you know, yuppie, come here, please, we're so happy to have you. It's always a bit of skepticism. There is, of course, on an individual basis, it's a city that's founded on polytheism, so there's not a monolithic response to Documenta either. There's many different there's a huge range of responses, and I think this makes for a pretty healthy, actually, public sphere. So in September of last year, we started a more public program, which is headed by the curator Paul Preciado. And we began what he terms the Parliament of Bodies, a kind of counter-parliament to the government formations that are currently crumbling around Europe and in the US, with 34 exercises of freedom. The sense there was that the participating artists of Documenta and some other guests would do something that they felt was an exercise of freedom, in the sense that freedom is something that we cannot say we have. Freedom is something that has to be exercised like a muscle in order to exist. And this has allowed us to have a kind of much stronger public dialogue. So in a way, things have already begun in Athens. And the 100 days that will begin on April 8th are a kind of culmination. But as you can see, you know, from the images of the work at the Mentis factory, I didn't have images of it because I think that there's something nice about narrating an oral corporation's work, but, you know, measurements of women in the Documenta female workforce have also begun for the Yugo form. So there's a lot of work that I would say is already happening. And this creates a kind of different form of public. Just to answer your question about what is public awareness, I think what we're trying to do is have a kind of public situation where people are working together towards something. So it's not a kind of presentation audience, you know, but a common task.
But it's also, you know, thinking, I'm not interested in numbers. It's more interesting to talk about who is participating, who is using, who will be benefit from Documenta in Athens. From the outside, from an outside perspective, is it true, and this is what people, I have been to Athens, I think the last time 3 years ago, and it's, and I know now through you, but also through others, many people who are visiting Athens frequently or living there, is it true that the financial crisis from 2008, 2009, plus the refugee crisis set up a very massive potential of creativity? In both in an economic order, yeah, because of the financial crisis, but also in terms of, let's call it, creative, art production or production of creativity. And those people are definitely might be not part of Documenta.
I mean, there's a lot of creative people in Athens who are not a part of Documenta. I think it's impossible to formally engage. A lot of people come out to, you know, participate in various ways. But I think that that's one of the big differences between Kassel and Athens, too, is that in Athens, of course, you're part of many things that are happening. There's a biennial in Athens. There is an art academy in Athens. There are museums that, you know, do their own programming. There is a lot of artist-run space. Well, a lot. There's a few really interesting artist-run spaces that are very much doing their own thing. And, you know, we're not Borg. We're not trying to, like, incorporate everything. We're trying to sort of coexist, and of course, you are a little bit of the elephant. You're bigger than many entities. You wield a different kind of financial possibilities, so there's a lot of expectation that not all of it can be filled. But I think It's a strange situation where I think people are looking at Athens right now, in part because Documenta went there as like, is this another hot city? Is this the next place where things will happen or something like that? I have a feeling in Athens things just happen a little bit differently in terms of that. People have slowly been doing various things. The crisis did not collapse everybody. Things kept going. There was actually very interesting things that kept going. So I don't know. It's hard to gauge what kind of effect Documenta has had. And yeah,
I know that those questions always sound a bit negative, but it's. Definitely don't want to be negative at all. Gentrification can be also a very good thing, and especially for Athens. But I'm asking myself more the question, what does it mean for not for future documentas, but more for future events of such global recognition? So how do we go in the future with the model of a biennial, of a documenta, of a huge global festival? What does it mean to people locally, globally? How do we communicate those elitist practices which are under, you know, so hard, widely criticized by the new politicians nowadays? What does it mean for our future working in this field, participating as spectators, as visitors? What does it mean to all of us? And that is, you know, what would have happened, what if scenario, if Adam Szymczyk would have had, how would he have decided today, going to Athens or to the US? You know, so all those questions are just coming into my mind, thinking about this. But again, and it's for the very first time that I think that it's very important that the artist list is not communicated.
Yeah.
Yeah. Not communicated. Okay. I don't want to keep it only between the two of us. Questions.
Who is financing Documenta?
Yes.
I don't know the exact percentages, but it's the Bundeskulturstiftung, it's the city of Kassel, and it's the land of Hessen are the main funders who make it possible for Documenta to kind of get going. Then there is, of course, many bigger sponsors that want to come forward and be present, like Volkswagen, Sparkasse, these types of large corporate sponsors that kind of step up and give very substantial amounts. There's a lot of embassies, well, not a lot, there's substantial embassies and kind of national funds that give, but not all nations. And this makes actually the three artists I've just spoken about, even though one of them has a French passport, they're quite difficult to fund. Mali, Serbia, Guatemala, it's not a simple situation, especially because these, I mean, except for one, they don't have gallery representation, so it becomes a complex kind of tango with, you know, foundations that basically, you know, demand applications, and you have to rationalize a whole number of criteria that they set in place, as well as what the artists want to do. So it's a very complex kind of pool of funding. But
you as an employee, mm-hmm. an example, you as an employee by Documenta, you get paid by?
I'm on contract to Documenta. I'm not an employee. But I get paid because there is funding from these three main sponsors that I told you about, which is the Land of Hessen, the Bundeskulturstiftung, and the city of Kassel. And that's actually really important.
Yes, I just wanted to make it very practical.
Yeah.
So this is also
It's practical, and it's also really important because I think that it's not, there is a huge weight of the funding is from public funds. People paying taxes, basically. And there is a very different kind of public responsibility because of that for Documenta. There was a lot of debate in Kassel about what it means to take Documenta and this public funding to Kassel, to Athens. Because, of course, the funding is predicated on the celebration of the Documenta in Kassel. So it sets up a lot of interesting problems, and I think for us it's been very important to align ourselves with public institutions in Greece, which are fledgling. So the Athens School of Fine Arts, the municipality of Athens, the Museum of Contemporary Art in Athens, the Banaki, which is half funded actually publicly. So these are, this is a kind of priority. You could go to Athens and do an exhibition in many disused industrial spaces that nobody else is using. You can find space, no problem. But to actually engage yourself with institutions is a whole other thing. Yeah.
Hi, last row in life. Perhaps I missed the point, but I don't understand why there's no list of participating artists. Mm-hmm. Will there be a list, or will this be the mystery Documenta, and we go there and we don't know what we will see, or?
You'll definitely go there and probably not know what you will see. I mean, hopefully you'll go there to discover lots of things. I think it's just on the one hand, it's an attempt to slow down perception, make possible experience, rather than a kind of pre-consumption of certain names. Because what does it mean, a name, actually, without seeing, you know, the work that is installed for this purpose? And there is various ways of communicating various artists' participation, but there isn't a kind of centralized list. In part, this is to break this very well-worn art world convention, and to kind of reorient, and not to give the sense that there is a possibility of a complete Olympic viewpoint of this Documenta. There's lots of historical artists. There's contributions by that are not the same as commissioning an artist, for instance. So just to publish a list of artists is very complicated, and it kind of levels out people according to names in a very strange way. So I think we are trying to question a bit why this is just done without necessarily so much thinking. It's just always done.
At the same time, it's important for artists too to be present. I mean, if you are not in this elitary circle, that you know who is participating, because you said you will know in a way, but perhaps I will never know. Perhaps I'm not in this network.
No, I mean, once the exhibition goes up, I'm sorry, the artists will be published with some content. So it will never be just a list. There will always be content. So on the website, even if you're far away in the world, you will know who's participating in Documenta. I'm sorry, I didn't... it's not about being cagey or kind of withholding information. It's about kind of presenting it with some substance.
Does it not... From my understanding, it has also a lot to do with the dominance of the art market. The list is not published.
You know, in a way, I think, but at the same time, to directly confront the art market is just a way to strengthen that. That's not the main reason. Yeah.
What about all the refugees and your title today? Do you have any connection, any work with them?
There is quite a few artists, both in Athens and in Kassel, who are connecting in different ways to newly arrived refugees, but also people who've immigrants that have settled in Athens for some time in really different ways. I can maybe offer one example because it gives a little bit of substance to what I'm saying instead of just saying, oh, there's lots of different ways. But for instance, the artist Rick Lowe, who is based in Houston in Texas, is working currently with about seven different, it's actually more. He's working with various kind of national communities, so Afghan communities, Senegalese communities, Nigerian community, Albanian community, and various organizations. One really amazing one in Athens is called Melissa, which means bee. And it's nice that it's called Bee because it's in a neighborhood called Kipseli, which means beehive. And Kipseli is a very telling neighbor. It's a very interesting neighborhood in Athens. It's used to be kind of very beautiful old housing stock that was kind of abandoned by an haute bourgeoisie in about the 70s, 80s, when there was a lot of building activity that expanded Athens into the suburbs right after the junta, and during the junta, actually. This city center parts got evacuated, and in came an influx of various refugees, mostly actually from Africa in Kipseli. So there's people from all over Africa there, from Ethiopia, from Senegal, from Ghana, from Nigeria, from you name it. It's created a kind of very interesting hub in Athens that I think Rick, being somebody that worked in the Third Ward in Houston, which is predominantly African-American, traditionally very economic, depressed neighborhood, but now kind of trying to actually slow down the process of gentrification because the project he installed in Houston called Project Row Houses is doing so well that he's trying to basically make sure that all the land around in the Third Ward is not going to be bought up by developers because all of a sudden Third Ward is kind of sexy. So he's taking some of the lessons of that and looking at a kind of very specific zone in Kipseli called Victoria Square, and he's going to base a project there which involves many different, not just refugee groups, but also immigrant groups or people who are kind of, there's a whole network of second generation, the generation 2.0, they call themselves. So these are children of people who have come from afar, and only 2 years ago did they win the right to be citizens in Greece because of this kind of ithagenia or the indigenous law. So yeah, it's there's a quite broad involvement with this whole complex question that's kind of permeating Europe right now and other places. Yeah. Okay. Anybody in the audience Greek by any chance? No. Just curious.
No one. That's interesting.
Yeah, it's interesting because it's a.
Is the Greek government having any kind of issue with this German cultural thing coming to Greece? Because I've heard like kind of wealthy Greek people kind of trash the Germans for taking all of the industry out of Greece, more or less, which I think is pretty accurate. So have you come across any of this in the process?
On an official level, like from the government, from the mayor, the Kaminis, or the national kind of level, no. And there is also a, let's say, a lot of people who are wealthy in Greece and who are not so wealthy in Greece who have very strong connections to Germany. So it's super complicated. There's a lot of marriages between Greeks and Germans. You find out about these things when you do a project like this, because of course it kind of like is structured to make visible all of it. But of course there is some skepticism, and it's not like there isn't any sense that the structure of Europe is very particular, and it's, you know, that the indebted south is indebted to the north, and the center of that is Germany in some ways. So I think this is definitely at play on the ground, and it's exactly this tension that this documenta is moving into and trying to work within somehow. Maybe make it a bit more visible, or show it for its complexity, because of course the first king of modern Greece was Otto of Bavaria. So there's like this kind of, you know, if you go to Kassel, the first you see the Fredericianum, when the where the documenta is traditionally kind of located or centered. I mean, it's a completely neoclassical structure. So the indebtedness of, let's say, German Enlightenment to the Greek classical ideal is very present in Kassel. So it goes both ways.
Yeah. Monika, thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
I hope you all will go to Athens. It opens again April 8th.